Welcome to Brew Cheese, where we brew up the finest of cheese. Today I have for you a deck tech in Melek, Izzet, Paragon. Melek is 4, a blue, and a red for a 2/4 weird wizard. He has a display with the top card of our library revealed and lets us cast that card if it's an instant or sorcery, and then if we do, we copy that spell. Melek is pretty straightforward and at the same time very complex. It's obvious he wants us casting instants and sorceries, but which ones? Maybe we cast big X spells and copy those for huge value, effectively doubling our mana that we put into that spell. Maybe we cast draw spells and copy those and draw all the cards. Or maybe we storm off, casting things like High Tide and Seething Song off our library, and copying those several times over until we either build up a huge storm count or have all the mana we could ever need that turn. That does sound like fun, and maybe in a future deck build. But not today. Today, we're going to catch opponents completely by surprise when we start destroying lands 2 at a time, sometimes 4 at a time, bouncing everything they've managed to play, and then punish them for keeping cards in hand, since they either can't play them now, or they were returned. One word of warning about this approach. It doesn't scale very well. If you're facing off against your average 3 opponents in a standard game, it'll do fine. Start adding more players and you're probably not going to be able to keep up. That's the caveat of any control deck. On the inverse, controlling 2 opponents is far easier than 3. There's also a strategy involved when playing land destruction. Although it may look like that strategy is just to simply destroy as many of them as possible, we can be a little smarter than that. If an opponent is playing 2 or more colors, deny them one of those colors, and make sure it is the right color to be denying them. A player playing green is particularly dangerous to our strategy because they have access to a lot of ramp, whether it's in the form of mana elves, or spells that get lands and put them into play, or enchantments that go on a land and increase their production. They'll have a hard time getting that started if we can take out their green mana production early on, but sometimes we might be forced to go after their secondary color. Denying blue limits the amount of counter magic we might face or draw power they might employ to help find more lands. Analyze their strategy, determine the weak point, and strike. Having said all that, onto the deck list. We'll be running Izzet's Signet, which fixes our mana and ramps us a bit, tapping for a blue and a red whenever we put a mana into it and tap it. Talisman of Creativity will ping us if we use it for colored mana, but we're not all too concerned with taking minor damage. There will also be plenty of times where colorless mana will do just fine. Commander's Sphere simply taps for one of our colors in our color identity, but can also be sacrificed to draw a card. This is important, as sometimes the top card of our deck isn't something Melek lets us cast, such as a land or a creature, and drawing it is a great way to get it out of the way. Star Compass taps for blue or red, provided we have an island or mountain in play, while Iron and Silver Mirror tap for a red or a blue respectively. Prismatic Lens taps for a colorless, but if we need it to, it can also filter one of our mana, in the event that we get a shortage of one mana type, or we hit a pocket of spells that are all one color and need to convert some mana. Mind Stone also taps for colorless, but lets us sacrifice it to draw a card, which, similar to Commander's Sphere, is useful for getting the top card out of the way when it's not an instant or sorcery. Milliken and Deranged Assistant are more or less the same, both costing 2 and tapping for a colorless, and milling us for 1 whenever they do. Since we always know what the top card of our deck is while Melek is out, we'll know if this is going to hurt us or not, and as always, there are times where we need the top card out of the way. Vidalion Arcanist and Curious Homunculus both tap for colorless, but this is only usable to cast instants and sorceries. Once you've accumulated a few of these in your graveyard, though, Homunculus flips into Voracious Reader, giving us a discount on all of our instants and sorceries. Its prowess ability isn't particularly important, but there will be plenty of times where we can use the reader to get in some extra damage on opponents that have an open board. We finish up our ramp with Brass's Bounty, which costs 7 but gives us a treasure token for every land we have out. If we can copy this with our commander, we'll be able to generate an incredible amount of treasure tokens. Although we're done with ramp, we're not done reducing costs. Although we're not a storm deck, we are hoping to play multiple instants and sorceries off our deck every turn. The ability to reduce the cost of each of those is going to help us achieve that goal. Goblin Electromancer, Jace's Sanctum, and Primal Amulet each discount those spells by 1, except Jace's Sanctum lets us scry whenever we cast instants and sorceries, which is valuable for manipulating the top card of our deck, while Primal Amulet flips into Primal Wellspring, which taps for any color mana, and when this mana is used to cast an instant or sorcery, we copy it. Arcane Melee reduces the cost of our instants and sorceries by 2, but it also reduces the cost of our opponents as well. Notice it doesn't have the "you cast" text in there like the others. Overall, we should be casting a lot more of these spells than our opponents and get greater benefit out of it. Occasionally, there will be a need to hit the reset button. Star of Extinction will not only destroy a land, something we're trying to do, but also kills most any creature or planeswalker. Chain Reaction lets us deal with boards where the amount of creatures has gotten out of control, dealing X damage to each creature, where X is the number of creatures. Magma Quake is not only instant speed, but also hits planeswalkers as well. Of course, with any of these red board wipes, doubling them up with Melek vastly increases their effectiveness. Washout bounces everything of the color of our choice, so we might be able to get away with naming a color other than blue or red and not lose anything of ours. But if we do, then we can recast it, while our opponents might not be able to redeploy so quickly thanks to the land destruction we're running. Not to mention, we do usually have only a minimum of colored permanents out, so redeploying is not very difficult for us. If we get to cast this off our library, we can return a load of creatures, because we'll get to pick 2 different colors. Like almost any deck running blue, we're running some counterspells, although their primary goal is just to protect our stuff and keep opponents from playing important combo pieces. But when you're playing a deck that likes to play off the top of our library, a standard counterspell can be just as much of a dead card as a land. We were looking to play 3 or 4 spells, but now we have to either stop or get the counterspell out of the way by milling it off or drawing it, or worse, countering our own spell. What do we do? Well, my approach is to go with only modal counterspells, so that if we have to use them for one of their other modes, we can continue our momentum of playing cards off our library. Archmage's Charm can let us steal a Sol Ring or a token off an opponent for the rest of the game, or draw us 2 cards. If we double this, we can steal 2 things, draw 4 cards, or whatever combination we want. Izzet Charm isn't the hard counter that Archmage is, but if we do cast this off our library as a counterspell, then making someone pay 4 to keep their spell is often just as good. We can also just use it to kill off a creature or loot. Warping Whale only counters sorceries, but those can be some of the most devastating effects in the game. We can also use it to exile a creature with low toughness, or to create an Eldrazi Scion or 2 to keep the spellcasting party going. Insidious Will, if we're playing it off the top of our library, we can most often use to copy a spell. But imagine if Insidious Will itself gets copied. If we cast and copy a land destruction spell off the top of our library, and then cast and copy Insidious Will, both times copying the other spell, we destroy 4 lands, or maybe we bounce 4 permanents with a bounce spell. Supreme Will, similar to Izzet Charm, isn't a hard counter, but very often 3 extra mana is too much to ask. And then of course 6 extra mana, they have to make sure they really, really want that spell to resolve, should we get to copy this. We can also just use it to pick a card out of the top 4 of our library, or 2 cards out of the top 8. We're only running a few other copy effects, because we're already going to get a little clogged with lands and our ramp pieces when we're trying to cast a bunch of spells off our library. And as nice as instant-based copy spells are, I'd hate to have one of those on top of the library with nothing to copy. but we're running two budget pieces that I feel like we can't ignore. Dual casting lets us tap the creature it's on, and for the cost of one red, copy a spell. It's cheap to cast, cheap to activate, and it's long-term value. Rao not only lets us scry when we need to, which is valuable for setting up the top card of our library or clearing away things we don't need, he also lets us copy something as well. And then, as a nice bonus, he lets us ping another player or planeswalker with every spell and copy of a spell that comes from our direction. As you might have guessed, we're running land destruction, and a lot of them. Seismic Spike is probably the best of the bunch, costing us 4, but giving us 2 mana back. If we copy this, we get 4 mana back, essentially making it a free spell that destroys 2 lands. Raise requires us to sacrifice a land ourselves in order to cast it, but we only have to do that once, even if we copy it. Considering most of the time our casting chain ends when we hit a land or a ramp piece, we will very likely always be drawing a mana source on our draw step, which means losing a land won't hurt us very much. Molten Rain not only destroys a land, it hits our opponent for 2 if that land was non-basic, something that's extremely common in EDH. If we can blow up 2 of those and deal 4, we get even better value. Stone Rain, you all know what it does. It destroys a land for 3 mana with no frills or fuss. Pillage and Demolish let us destroy an artifact or a land, but with Pillage, if that thing has regeneration, it won't do it any good. You know, for all those regenerating lands out there. Sunder from Within, like Demolish, also destroys an artifact or land for 4 mana. The flexibility on these spells to destroy an artifact may come in handy in case we have to destroy any big mana rocks like Gilded Lotus. Dwarven Landslide destroys a land for 4 mana, but if we can pay the kicker as well, we destroy a second one. Keep in mind that if you copy a kicked spell, the copy is also kicked, meaning we destroy 4 lands with 1 spell. Also keep in mind that cost reduction effects do reduce the cost of kicker as well. Earth Rift also destroys a land for 4 mana, but also gives us flashback should we need to do it again later. Icefall destroys an artifact or land for 4, but when one of our creatures dies, we can pay 2 red and return this to our hand to use again. Melt Terrain, similar to Molten Rain, destroys a land and deals 2 damage to an opponent, but we don't have to destroy a non-basic land to get that benefit. Roiling Terrain destroys a land, but then also hits that opponent for a damage for every land they have in their graveyard. If there's any spell we hope to copy, it's this one. Rubble Reading destroys a land, but also scries for 2, and I've already covered how valuable Scry is for this deck. Violent Impact destroys an artifact or land, but if for some reason we don't need it in our hand, we can cycle it away. Volcanic Offering destroys a non-basic land for 5 mana, but then has our opponent pick a non-basic land we don't control and destroy that too. On top of that, we get to take out a creature, and then they pick out a creature that's not ours and deal 7 damage to it as well. Without even copying this spell, we get a potential 4 for 1. Imagine the value if you do get to copy it off the top of your deck. Rain of Salt is more or less 2 stone rains stapled to each other, costing 6 mana to destroy 2 lands without any sort of catch. With cost reduction effects in play, and if we cast this off the top of our library, we could potentially be paying as little as 2 mana to destroy 4 lands. But of course, people are going to get a few things out before the ball really starts rolling, and we'll probably manage to play even more stuff as the game goes on. We can control this by returning early game plays back to their hand, forcing them to either use what little mana they have left to redeploy them, or not having the mana any longer to use. We can also use some of the instant speed bounce effects to save important pieces of ours, such as our win cons from removal or board wipes. Void Snare is a sorcery speed spell, but only costs 1 mana to return any non-land permanent. Blink of an Eye and Into the Royal are the exact same card, costing us 2 to bounce a non-land permanent and giving us the option to kick it if we want to draw a card. Disperse and Expel from Orozca bounce a non-land permanent as well, but Expel has the added possibility of putting that card on top of their deck instead if we have 10 permanents out. Although this effect is nice, and even nicer when copied, it's not required for getting good use out of this card. Depths of Desire returns a creature to its owner's hand, and it makes us a treasure token while doing so, making it effectively only cost 2. If we copy this, we're only paying 1 net mana to bounce 2 things. If we have any cost reduction effects in play, we could be casting this for free or even gaining mana. Perilous Voyage bounces a non-land permanent, and if we choose to bounce something that's CMC 2 or less, we get to scry 2. Since scrying is so useful, we may just take that offer and get rid of a Signet or some other cheap mana source of an opponent. These next bounce spells all have one important thing in common, and that's a lack of the word non-land. This means that in a pinch, you can use any of these to return a land to its owner's hand, setting them back a turn on trying to recover from all the destruction we're doing. Boomerang is the classic example, bouncing anything at all for only 2 mana. Eye of Nowhere is more or less identical, except it's at sorcery speed. Consigned to Dream bounces something, and if that something was Christmas colors, it goes on the top of that player's deck instead. Capsize is a multiple-use bounce spell, so long as we can afford the buyback cost on it. Keep in mind that cost reducers reduce total cost of a spell, so if we add the buyback cost on, we may end up paying far less than 6 mana to cast it and keep it afterward. Regress and Rescind both cost us 3 to bounce any permanent as well, but Rescind allows us to cycle it if we need to. Of course, despite all the stuff the deck is doing, it's going to eventually lose if all we have to rely on for victory is incidental burn coming from our land destruction spells. Some of our win conditions are Ebony Owl Netsuke, which deals 4 damage to an opponent on their upkeep if they have a full hand of 7 cards. Iron Maiden and Viceling deal damage to our opponents on their upkeep for each card in their hand over 4, meaning they'll take 3 if they have a full hand, or possibly more if we bounce some things since their last turn. Gutter Snipe will take full advantage of all the spells we're casting, hitting each of our opponents for 2 every time we cast an instant or sorcery. Unfortunately, this does not trigger on copies like Ral does, but we're still going to be triggering this effect a lot. Jaya's Immolating Inferno requires us to have our commander or Ral in play, but if we get the chance to cast this with either a lot of mana or just by copying it, we can easily wipe out all 3 of our opponents. It's worth mentioning that cost reduction effects let you effectively add to the value of X. Let's say we have this on top of our library and have 9 mana available, and 3 effects that reduce the cost of instants and sorceries by 1 each. We cast this, declaring X to be 10, and that sets the total cost of the spell at 12 mana, 10 from X, and the base cost of 2 red. Our cost reducers take this down to 9 total mana, the amount we have available, while keeping the value of X at 10. Since we're casting this off the top of our library, we'll be copying it, meaning we pay 9 mana to deal 20 damage to each of our opponents. To kick off our mana base, we're running a copy of Encroaching Wastes and Memorial to War. Both extend out our land destruction capability a bit if we're in a situation to sacrifice them, but they also provide mana until that point. Survivor's Encampment and Holdout Settlement are the exact same card, each tapping for a colorless or letting you tap a creature and it to make any color of mana. We can use our commander or one of our creatures that produces specialized mana, such as mana that can only be used for an instant or sorcery, to produce some colored mana. Spire of Industry and Command Tower are each going to provide red and blue for us, except Spire of Industry comes at a cost of 1 life and we have to have an artifact in play. Even if we don't, it still taps for colorless mana and comes in untapped. Spire of Industry is honestly one of the best budget lands in Commander, since most decks are going to be running a fair amount of mana rocks and other artifacts. We're also running Izzet Guildgate, Swiftwater Cliffs, and Temple of Epiphany. They each tap for either a red or a blue and enter tapped, but Cliffs will give us a life and the Temple will scry for us. Highland Lake is more or less identical to Izzet Guildgate, with the exception of not having the gate subtype. Shivan Reef both enters untapped and can produce either colorless or red or blue, but at the cost of 1 damage. We're not really going to care about this incidental damage, and there will be plenty of times that we can just use it for the colorless production. Sulfur Falls enters tapped unless we have an island or a mountain, and it also produces Izzet colors. We're also running Izzet Boiler Works, which requires us to bounce a land back to our hand and then taps for both a blue and a red. We don't have to return a tapped land, so it's possible to not lose too much momentum by playing this. Finally, our mana base concludes with 11 mountains and 13 islands, bringing our total to 37 lands. So, what's the damage? All of these cards will cost as low as $21.17, with those prices including cards of any condition located on TCG Player, not a sponsor. That price does exclude shipping, which I'll cover in a future video. I'd like to thank all of our viewers, and if you like what we're doing here, spread the word via subscription, sharing, town crier, or just leave a comment telling us something you'd like to see in a future video. Thank you again, and see you next video.